What do you think needs to be done at the federal level to ensure that foreign entities aren't meddling in future elections?
Well, one of the things that we're working on right now is working with the states to make sure that they have ballot security, and it's not just against foreign interest. Anyone who tries to influence an election, whether it's a domestic source or an international source, that needs to be prosecuted. We've gone through various elections where there have been outside groups such as ACORN that were registering people, making up names. There are people who've been arrested already, but in particular one lady in Nevada who's in federal prison right now because of election fraud. So it's not just an international issue, it's a domestic issue as well. I think that every vote, every legitimate vote should be counted. But those people who are trying to steal an election, I don't care if they're from Alabama or from Canada or anywhere else, should be arrested and prosecuted.
Do you think at this point that we're ahead of the situation or playing catch up?
Well, I think the investigation into the so-called Russian influence or intervention in our election has proven that they had no impact. I think that it depends on the states. The elections are properly the purview of the states. Here in Alabama, I have great confidence in Secretary of State John Merrill and the job that he's doing. So I feel that our elections are secure. The thing that concerns me is in the states where they're allowing people who are not here legally to vote to get driver's license and to allow them to vote, and registration of people that are made up names. We've seen several cases where there'd be 20 or 30 people or more at one address that are being registered to vote. We've seen cases where people are being paid by the number of people that they get registered, so they make up names. So I think that's the big problem. You have to stay on top of that. You have to stay on top of the absentee ballots. But again, you know, anybody that thinks that that other nations are influencing the outcome of our elections more so than people inside who are trying to steal elections, I think need to take another look at it.
Ask you about immigration as well. There was a Gallup poll in June that showed 57% of those surveyed opposed expanding the border wall. Immigration reform and border security continue to be policy issues that are hotly debated across the country. What do you want to see done to improve border security?
Well, I think border security is a huge issue for us, and the wall is a part of it. But when you're thinking about the wall, it's not about trying to stop some poor guy from coming over here to make a better life for his family. That's not the issue. The issue is the number of people who are coming across that are being arrested, who are coming from countries that are either state sponsors of terrorism or known to produce terrorists, or these individuals have been affiliated with a terrorist organization. And we're arresting anywhere from 10 to 12 per day. Now, I want to emphasize that. We're arresting 10 to 12 per day in that category that I just mentioned of potential ties to terrorist organizations. Last year, we interdicted 2,700 pounds of fentanyl. That's enough to kill 500 million Americans. We're arresting people who are bringing young women across the border in human trafficking, an unspeakable tragedy that's being played out at our border. And on top of that, we're interdicting people who are bringing firearms into the country. So when people talk about border security, they shouldn't think of it in the context of immigration. It's really about our national security. And I'll gladly stand any day of the week and argue for securing our borders.
Do you see the border wall as a key piece of controlling immigration, and do you support it?
Well, absolutely I support it. The border wall is not necessarily a physical barrier. Obviously, along the Texas border, we've got the Rio Grande River. We're not going to wall off the Rio Grande River. What we mean when we talk about a border wall, that's a combination of physical and technical. Using aerostats, for instance, or drones to use the technology to look into across the border to see who's staging to come across. But we've also got to hire more Border Patrol agents, and they need to be forward deployed. During the Obama administration, the Department of Interior wouldn't allow Border Patrol to cross certain areas of federal land because it would harm the environment. So I visited the border in Arizona. We had Border Patrol that were stationed 20 or more miles away from the border. But you go out to the wall, they'd come in, they'd cut through the fence, and you'd see pickup tracks where they literally drove over the fence through federal land. It'd be tracks all over the place, but our people couldn't go into those areas. So what I think we've got to do is we've got to have a combination of a physical wall, use our technology, but we've got to forward deploy our border patrol so that when these people are staging, they're able to move to that point and prevent them from even attempting to cross.
Where do you see the funding for these projects coming from?
There are a number of areas that will provide the funding. That's not an issue. I mean, this is not something that's going to be built in a year. So when you're talking about approximately $20 to $25 billion, that's going to be spread over a period of time. But we can get the resources to do that.
The poll I mentioned earlier also asked individuals about immigration, and 70% of the surveyed said that most undocumented immigrants currently working in the U.S. should be offered a chance to apply for legal status. Do you support a legal path to citizenship for those currently in the United States?
I think we can work that out. I think most people agree that if they've been here and they've held stable jobs, that there ought to be a legal pathway for them to come, but it cannot be without some form of restitution. We have the rule of law for a reason. The law has to apply equally to everyone. And I think one of the bigger issues that we need to address that a lot of people don't talk about is how do we assimilate those people into our communities? And I think if we can figure out a way for them to get right with the law, you know, through restitution or some other form, not only would they be able to get legal status to be here, but I think the majority of Americans would accept them. But if we just give them amnesty, as a lot of liberals and left-wingers want to do, then not only do we undermine the rule of law, we undermine the ability to assimilate those folks into our communities as our neighbors and our friends and colleagues.
I want to ask you about trade as well. The president has recently imposed tariffs on a number of items with certain countries, including allies like Canada. Half of those surveyed disapprove of how the president's handling international trade. Do you support his policies when it comes to trade policies and tariffs?
I'm not big on tariffs. I never have been. I think tariffs are a tax that get passed on to the consumer. At the same time, I understand the validity of using targeted tariffs. For instance, Canada did tremendous harm to the sawmill industry in the Southeast, particularly here in Alabama, by dumping Canadian lumber into the market. China has done tremendous harm to the steel industry and to the furniture industry and now to the cabinet industry by dumping product into our market, and particularly finished product. And what happens is China will, particularly on steel, will do finished product, but they won't stamp their country of origin on it. They'll send it to Malaysia or Thailand or someplace like that, and then they dump it into the marketplace, and it's everything from steel pipe to coat hangers. So I think that targeted tariffs make sense. Canada has taken advantage of the United States, and I think we're working that out. Europe has taken advantage of the United States, and I think we're making progress there. But I think the best way to deal with this, and particularly with China, is to utilize our enormous energy resources. We need to lead the world in the export of crude oil and liquefied natural gas. That not only increases our GDP, it reduces our trade imbalance. There's one research group out of New York projected that over a 15-year period, just the export of crude oil could add $1.3 trillion in new government revenues. And another report indicated it would add $1 trillion to our GDP. If we did that and we pivoted away from China as a major economy and more to, say, India, which has the fastest growing economy in the world, and in the next 25 to 30 years will be the second largest economy in the world, I think that's how you deal with China. That's where you can put pressure on the Chinese, because they don't play a short game, they play the long game. We're working trade agreements now with Vietnam. The Asian Development Bank projects that their economy is going to grow at 6.5%, and they don't want to have anything to do with China. They want to work with us. So I think we have positioned ourselves in the last 2 years such that we're respected again, and where a lot of people thought the United States was a declining power and that China was the emerging power, I think we've reversed that perception.
real quick, do you worry about the impact they could have on the growing auto industry in Alabama?
Well, it raises concern, but I think this is going to be worked out in a fairly short amount of time.
I want to ask you about another poll. There was an NPR Marist poll taken earlier this year, and more than half of those surveyed said that stricter gun legislation should be an immediate priority for Congress. Where do you stand on gun control and why?
I'm opposed to gun control. I mean, we've got laws out our ears on gun control. That doesn't make sense, and I think what we've got to do is we've got to deal with the underlying issues of family breakdown, economic opportunity, a decrepit education system, particularly in places like Chicago that's become a virtual war zone that is driving Rahm Emanuel out of office as mayor up there. But, you know, those are your typical liberal left-wing talking points that are hot buttons for them, but for the majority of Americans, I don't think they want to see us abandon the Second Amendment.
The president has taken aim at the Attorney General in recent months. Do you support Jeff Sessions as Attorney General?
I think Jeff Sessions is doing his job. The Attorney General's position has to be really like the totally non-political. The Attorney General cannot be like the Obama Justice Department, where clearly Eric Holder and Loretta Lynch were political. They were there to protect Obama. They protected Loretta Lynch at the IRS. They made sure that it was a political Department of Justice. I think what Jeff Sessions is doing is restoring the rule of law and blind justice to the Department of Justice. There are things going on that my colleagues and I know about that we can't talk about in terms of investigations that I think is going to shed light on how the Justice Department prior to this administration was run, and one of the reasons why you need someone who will not politicize that office, who will uphold the law without regard to who's in office. I think that's what Attorney General Sessions is trying to do. I think the real evaluation of his tenure as U.S. Attorney General will be after he leaves office and we see the results of what he's done internally to try to get the Justice Department back to where it ought to be. But I can tell you right now, I serve on the Oversight Committee. I've been involved in a number of hearings. And what went on in the previous administration was a travesty. Everything from what happened at the border with the murder of one of our Border Patrol agents because of an operation being run by the Justice Department, Fast and Furious, and the cover-up that was involved in that, and a number of other things that I think when history's finally written, if it's written the way it should be written, the American public will be astonished at what happened.